Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Morningside After Dark, where tonight we gather. I'm Rebecca Sorensen, one of your co-hosts. While we can't be with you in person just yet, we're so happy to offer this final virtual experience until we can gather again in person in 2022. Thank you for being here. A quick thank you to the incredible Morningside After Dark tech team working behind the scenes to make tonight possible. Andy Vogel of AV Photography and George Scott McKelvey made tonight happen from a technology and sound and streaming standpoint, and we are so grateful. We could not do this show without you.
Hi, I'm Jim Mahoney, a co-host of Morningside After Dark. Before we begin, we want to thank our amazing sponsors for making tonight possible. Thank you to Freak Flag Organics, Hyperbole, the best podcast ever, Surgeon Jane, Yoga Fit Studio Linden Hills, The 10 Spot, and Rebecca and Mark Sorensen. Our graphics are designed by Sen and Sons. Please don't hesitate to jump into Facebook Live during the show with questions or comments and share the love with our performers. This is our way of showing them our appreciation until we're back cheering and clapping in person once again.
Hi, all. I'm co-host Katie Vernon. We want to thank our season-long performance sponsor, Dissonance. I'm proud to be a board member of an organization that supports people in the arts community with mental health or substance abuse issues. If you or anyone you love is looking for help, please check out updated resources at dissonance.website. And now, let's gather together for Morningside After Dark.
Hi, freaky friends. Hope everyone's doing well. Looking forward to another amazing edition of Morningside After Dark. We really want to thank Rebecca and team for putting on such an amazing series and allowing us to be a part of it. It's been an absolute honor and thrill to be supporting just an amazing locally based organic homegrown program. And thank you for letting us be a part of this. And we want to thank all of you out there too that have supported Freak Flag Organics up to this point. Locally based, we really appreciate all the support. We have been fortunate enough to get our footprint into Whole Foods nationwide, and we're thrilled by the opportunity of actually launching our new Mac and Freak line. It's a new line of 100% USDA certified organic mac and cheeses with amazing flavor. We have our four cheese, our kick and kale cheddar, our broccoli and cheddar, and our Southwestern. Whoops, that's the back of the box. Whoops, there's the front of the box. So you have an opportunity to run into Whole Foods this week and pick these up. They are two for $4 for the next week and a half. Two for $4 at Whole Foods. Keep an eye out for our bone broths there and our dipping sauces as well. So yay for all that goody stuff. Want to thank you again for all the support. Hope everybody enjoys this show. Rebecca, Jim, everybody associated with Morningside After Dark, thank you so much for everything you guys do. We greatly appreciate it. Everybody, have a wonderful spring, summer, fall. Let's do this again next year. Until then, be well and stay freaky, friends.
Hi, my name is Sarah Souter Johnson, and I'm the co-founder and chair of the board for Dissonance. Dissonance is a local nonprofit organization with a mission to build healthy community in and through the arts. To challenge stigma about mental health and recovery, we have to look at all aspects of well-being, including financial security. Paying artists is one part of what we do, and we are proud to be this season's performance sponsor for Morningside After Dark. To learn more about us, visit us at www.dissonance.website. Thank you. And enjoy the show.
Hi, everybody. Happy Monday evening. And my name is Katie Vernon, and I'm really proud to be kicking off the event tonight. I wrote this song specially for you guys for this event. It's called Gather, and was inspired by everything we've been through and everything that we hope to get back to. So hope you enjoy it. This song's called Gather. I used to find an excuse of any kind. I'd already know. Thanks for gathering with us tonight. I hope you enjoy the rest of the performances. Thank you. Take care. Get vaccinated.
Hello, Morningside After Dark. My name's Kevin Kling, and I'm a storyteller from Minneapolis, Minnesota. I guess when I think of gathering, I think of my grandparents' farm. I loved going to their farm. We had what was called unstructured time, which now they call boredom, but I was never bored on that farm. I loved it. I've still never been bored to this day. I've been to some plays where I wished I was somewhere else and other plays where I would have fallen asleep if I hadn't been the one talking, but I've still never been bored. And I have my grandparents to thank. My grandpa, he smelled like tractor grease even in church. He could back up a trailer into a thimble, and he always referred to my guinea pig as livestock. From my grandpa, I learned, always carry a pocket knife and a pair of pliers and be good to your neighbors because you never knew when you were going to need them. My grandma was an amazing cook. Oh man, if grandpa could cut it off, grandma could cook it. And I remember our dining room table, all my uncles and aunts, and there was these pictures on the walls of relatives that I never knew, some in uniform and some before I was born. But somehow they were in that room with us. When I think of Gather, I think of the Minnesota Twins, 1987. I was at game number two in the Metrodome, our huge dome stadium. It was like made out of Tupperware. You were burped when you left. And I'm sitting there in a huge place. I turn to the guy next to me. I go, man, have you ever been in a place this big? And he goes, no. He says, if there is a deer on home plate, I wouldn't shoot it. It's too far to drag back. I'm like, oh, yeah, I know what you mean. And then I'm looking around. There's 50,000 screaming people, most of them Lutherans. I had never seen one Lutheran scream, let alone 50,000, screaming at the top of their lungs, screaming for the first time in their lives, screaming for the first time in their ancestors' lives, screaming for the first time since Martin Luther missed the nail and hit his thumb, they were screaming. Oh, but nobody was chewing gum because they hadn't brought enough for everyone. When I think of gathering, I think of a Prince concert where everyone is dancing at the same heartbeat, or going to the Guthrie Theater. And we all enter with different days, different lives, and then the lights go down. And when they come back up, we're transported. I mean, some of us get a much-needed laugh or a cry. Some know that they're not alone. And there we are, all together in that room. And we realize that we love, hate, and desire as much as any king or queen that ever lived, and that the play just simply reminds us of that. And at the end, when we all stand, there we are together, like we will be again. So I want to read you a quick poem that is called To Gather. The word gather conjures living rooms, dining rooms, tables, church basements, coffee shops, mosques, synagogues, and concert halls, joined by family, faith, community, a common language, music, food. Now, to gather doesn't mean to agree. It's a choice to be together, a fulfilled promise. It's recognition. It's a nest where we belong, resilient. I bring who I am to who we are, our herd, our pack, a constellation, each star bringing a little light to the vast darkness, each instrument, a voice in the silence. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Summer. I am a local musician in the Twin Cities. I make all types of music. I'm a very vibrant artist, and I'm always about coming together. And today I will be singing a song called Count On Me, sung originally by Whitney Houston and CeCe Winings. And it's just the best song about coming together and having someone to count on and depend on when sometimes you're having your low days, and that's okay. So I hope you guys enjoy it. I'm excited.
Count on me through thick and thin, a friendship that will never end. When you are weak, I will be strong, helping you to carry on. Call on me, I will be there. Don't be afraid.
I can see it's hurting you. I can feel your pain. It's hard to see the sunshine through the rain. Oh no. I know sometimes it seems as if it's never going to end, but we'll get through it. Just don't give in, 'cause you can count on me through thick and thin. A friendship that will never end. When you are weak, I will be strong, helping you to carry on. Call on me, I will be there. Don't be afraid. Please believe me when I say, count on, you can count on me. Oh, yes, you can.
I didn't have much of a say, and with these kids giving them a voice, it gives them the chance to feel as if they have a say in figuring out for themselves. Their story is their reality, in a sense.
Nothing that I'm aware of exists that's specifically like this, that has the minds that the Wildling has.
Hi, my name is Ashok Darwal. My wife and I own the Yoga Fit Studios in Minneapolis, including the one on 45th and France Avenue. We are honored to be a sponsor once again for Morningside After Dark. It will be our sixth year in a row. We're very grateful to be a part of this wonderful event. We wanted to share that we are doing about 100 in-studio classes per week across our four locations, and also about 50 virtual classes per week. If you're interested in joining a membership, we have some specials for Morningside After Dark fans and community, and you can email us at lindenhills@yogafitstudios.com. Thank you so much.
Hi, I'm Ari Tyson, a poet and an author from Minnesota. Today I'm reading a short piece of creative nonfiction called The Ceremony of the Ocean. To my people, the ocean is a woman. On our inland territory of mountain, valley, and rainforest, we can still see the path our ancestors took to the ocean. Generations and generations back, my people, the Bribris, named for the uneven land, would travel to the ocean once a year, the Awa leading the way, and a group of 15 or so following and singing with songs of travel. The entire journey would take months, but before even touching the coast, they could hear her roaring. Imagine, no speedboats, buses, cars, no tourists, no flashing cameras, no restaurants, no schools, no national parks, no German investors, no French bakeries, no pools. And instead, the bellowing of a woman over the choruses of birds and wind, and the howling of howler monkeys, and the whining of insects, and the cooling of rain. The forest is thick, and the path is sure. Each footing provided by my ancestors' ancestors and their ancestors, which are my ancestors, and so on. It has been years since I have been to my territory. The last time my father went, I was stuck in grad school, unable to afford to leave. And when he returned from Costa Rica, he returned half his usual compact size, his skin tired, nothing our skin would look like after months in the sun. It was a sickness that even puzzled Mayo, a rare form of multiple myeloma found, strong enough to keep him from traveling. Over the past 5 years, my father called his sister to complain to her about how much he felt like a pig tied to the post of Western medicine that was somehow deciding for him where his house must be, even if home was elsewhere. Finally, just barely before the pandemic shut down all travel, the doctors finally said he could travel back. But they said he could not touch the bodies of water. I heard him say, "How could they tell me not to touch my own river?" You see, my father was born by the river in our traditional way. The women go to the waterside ahead of time, set up camp, and birth alone. His first touch after his mother, likely a river, our water. With this pandemic, what my heart aches for more than anything is the ocean. I cry within the walls of my closet, surrounded by Minnesota sweaters, stacked up around me in swimsuits packed under bins and bins of winter gear. Outward from the walls of our one-bedroom apartment is brick, snow, ice, salt, to keep people from slipping in their cars in the midst of a nation where numbers are rising, the death toll ringing 100, 200,000 dead, 300, 400,000 dead. My goodness, what is this? I bear the weight and challenge of my American kind. The sickness is thick. It is harsh and heavy. And my body is even unhappy. My mind grows weary. Dreams reoccur. I've noticed my own skin has new blemishes on it. In a Minnesota winter, all I can do is sit in a bathtub three times a week, pour in salt, and soak. When our people go to the ocean, once they arrive at her roaring, glittering, and robust body of slick skin relatives, we would pray. You see, the people traveling with the Awa were the sick, and perhaps this is why this trip took so long. Those with skin conditions, those not feeling well, those in need. They, after prayers and offerings, would enter the warm blue glass water and soak. And there, the ocean herself would heal them. She would tend to their wounds, soothe their sores and spots, and she would caress their swollen feet, and she would heal them with her salt. Part of me wonders, what harm would it be to let my father soak? To do our traditional work of healing? Because in an interesting turn of events, the ocean, she's found her way into our most effective vaccines. Saline, the third ingredient, salt water. And I think about her after my father was given his first shot. And then I think about it again after I'm given mine. I wonder how the ocean must feel, that she has somehow found her way to us even when we cannot reach her. She will tend to our wounds, gather inside each of us, and heal. She has come to us, inland thousands of miles, ready to welcome us back.
Hello, everyone. My name is Tina Shaleski, and I'm very, very excited to be here on Morningside After Dark. And this is my song about Gather, and it's called The Keeper.
Goodbye. We'll meet again in the sweet by and by.
me.
Hello, Morningside After Dark. My name is Will McGrath, and it's great to be with you here again, virtually this time. Since our theme tonight is Gather, I thought I would tell you about the time I went to the world's largest gathering of Elvis Presley impersonators, which is an event that takes place in rural Canada. So this is an excerpt from something I'll be reading here. I'm 2 hours north of Toronto in a borrowed, bug-eyed Mercedes, rolling hard on Tim Hortons and intent on dodging the fuzz. With me is an ill-bred band of hooligans, upstarts, blowhards, and minor louts, one of whom I'm bound to by the treaties of holy matrimony, the others by various blood oaths and pacts of mutual degeneracy. We have come to the Great White North in search of the deep down South. We have come to see the kings. Up here, the roads are sun-baked gray, voluptuous and empty in a way that obligates fast driving. We blur through rural intersections and skim alongside golden shag. The Ontario farmland unfurls warmly around us. We pass the steady, moral ranch houses of Simcoe County, their front lawns populated with Muskoka chairs and wooden moose statuary. Here in the side yard, a gardener has colonized her strawberry patch with stone and crystal fairy figurines. Deep in the vegetation, a secret joke, a secret hope. A question. Why does one go to an Elvis Presley impersonator festival in the county of Simcoe, in the province of Ontario, in the country of Canada, on the planet of Earth? That question benefits from a slight rephrasing. In a rustic town in Ontario, there exists the world's largest Elvis Fest, a multi-day celebration involving parades of classic cars, carnival rides, Elvis flicks under the stars, hundreds of live performances, and a battle royale to determine the greatest Elvis impersonator on the planet. The rephrased question is, what kind of Philistine doesn't go? By the time the karate Elvises swagger into the dive bar where we've been roosting, it feels inevitable, feels like they've come looking for us. They appear to have a bit of drink in them already. We're stunt Elvises, one of the three yells at me. We do karate kicks and ride our dirt bikes over cliffs. They are dressed in familiar Elvis motif, the white rhinestone jumpsuits, the chunky gold sunglasses, but two of them have nunchaku tucked beneath knotted yellow belts that have perhaps been stolen from a child's martial arts class. Cool nunchucks, I say. And so they begin whirling their nunchaku in the air, flipping them under their arms and around their backs, and it feels like a victory when no one is injured in any significant way. The karate Elvises are pushing 30, pot-bellied and scruffy. One has a full beard, another is sporting a bushy Fu Manchu mustache and has his head bicked up the sides, his long hair greased straight back. All three are wearing plastic leis and plastic sheriff's badges. At their request, we join them in shots of Jägermeister, which feels both unseemly and like the only appropriate outcome of our encounter. They do this often, and they tell me, hit up the various festivals, but they never perform. They're just here to party and see some Elvises they know from the scene. One karate Elvis is a middle school teacher. Another works for a company that makes industrial plastic molds. When I ask them how they first got involved with Elvis Fest, this is what happens. Fu Manchu takes a step back from the group, turns his back, spreads his wings. He stands before us with a heavy satin cape that spans arm to arm, falls past his waistline in a perfect semicircle. While Fu Manchu presents his cape to us, bearded Elvis goes into a low boxer's crouch beside the cape, fists up, rings sparkling. This is their answer to my question. After a period of silence, bearded Elvis yells with some exasperation, "It's his wife's wedding dress." "My fucking ex-wife, man," Fu Manchu corrects over his shoulder, arms still spread wide. I reach out and touch it. The fabric is creamy and expensive, a dream on the fingertips. It is indeed part of a wedding dress, hacked off from the rest of the gown, now heavily bejeweled, little constellations of plastic gemstones glued everywhere. It has been professionally rehemmed. Fu Manchu's wife was cheating on him, he tells me, and when they split up, he fell into a bad, hard time. The other karate Elvises, pre-Elvises at the time, came by one day to help pack up the house. They found the wedding dress hanging in an empty closet. "Toss that thing," Fu Manchu said, but bearded Elvis stayed his hand. The three of them stood looking at it, awaiting inspiration. "Looks like something Liberace would have worn." "Yeah, or Elvis." This is how healing begins. All right, thanks so much. I'll have to tell you the rest of this story another time. This is an excerpt from a new book of mine that will be out next year. Have a great night, everyone.
It's the magic hour in South Minneapolis. Hey, Morningside. Very grateful to be a part of such a cool crew. Thanks so much to Katie. Thanks so much to Rebecca. Thanks so much to Jim. So what a crazy year. I wrote a little song about it. It goes something like this.
Canceled, now you just have to eat it. Not like it was selling out anyway. Yet the stock market booms, the fat get fatter. But each block of Lake Street makes me sadder, sadder. And only the fool can't see Black Lives Matter. 2020, please get in my hindsight. On the morning side of the dark, nights grow longer when we're apart. On the morning side after dark, we'll be all right. On the morning side of the dawn, Rico thunder when we're apart. On the morning side after dawn, we'll be alright.
I'm Jamie Carl, owner of Surgeon Jane up at 45th and France Avenue. We are a men's and women's lifestyle boutique, but we also offer kids apparel, kids toys, and we have a full pet bakery. If you're in the area, stop by and see us, and pets are always welcome. Thanks and have a great night.
Oh, hello, welcome to my bathtub. I was just sitting here thinking about how lucky I am to be able to experience Morningside After Dark right here from the luxury of a warm tub with that beautiful candlelit glow right behind me. It is truly the best thing ever. Wouldn't you agree, Danielle?
You are so right, Amy. Truer words have never been spoken.
We are so thankful to Rebecca and her incredible team of producers who have put together this virtual Morningside After Dark. It's incredible. The songs, the stories, the talent.
Traditionally, one usually gets dressed and wears clothing to Morningside After Dark. But not this month. This month is different.
It is beyond fabulous. And do you know what else is beyond fabulous? Hyperbole. The best podcast ever. You can listen to it wherever you get your podcasts. We'd be forever grateful. And hey, do it from the tub. All the cool cats and kittens are doing it.
Hi, I'm Lori Lindeen. I'm a writer. I used to live in Morningside. I am leading memoir writing workshops this summer on Madeline Island School of the Arts and memoir writing workshops in Santa Fe in March 2022. So if you're interested in exploring your own memoir, look up Madeline Island School of the Arts. Okay, here's a piece I wrote recently. It's called That Time My Mom's Obituary Went Viral. You may have read it on your news feed in late February. She wished that she had spoken up why a Wisconsin woman's obituary asks people to donate to Ron Johnson's political opponent. The Wisconsin woman was my mom. The writer of the obituary was me. The last sentence of her celebratory obituary, filled with the caveats of a life well lived, states, in lieu of flowers, please send donations to Ron Johnson's 2022 political opponent. Why did I do it? Here's the story. Less than a week before she passed, I drove to my hometown of Madison to visit her at the assisted living facilities. whatever reason, the angel who worked at the assisted living facilities allowed me to go back to my mom's room with her, even though she was not supposed to. I do know that my mom would lay on the emergency buzzer at all hours of day and night, so that's probably why she let me go and visit in her room. Once in the nest womb of her room, surrounded by her artwork and photographs, she poised in her day bed with 3 months of untended hair that looked like Don King's. In the background, her television was tuned to MSNBC, as it had been for years. Nicole Wallace introduced footage of Wisconsin Senator Ron Johnson downplaying the events at the Capitol on January 6th. Johnson made the insurrection sound like a Badger tailgate party that got a little out of hands. "I can't stand him," she said, followed by, "What a jackass." I nodded in agreement, and she closed her eyes and shook her head and said very quietly, "I wish I would have done more. I wish I would have spoken up and gotten more involved." During our visit, I trimmed her hair and stuck some self-affixing rollers in the frantic mess, and she told me that she had dreamt the night before that all four of her children stood around her bed to tell her that she was dying. She then cocked her head, looked directly at me, and said, "Am I dying?" And I said something to the tune of, while I didn't think she was actively dying at that moment, she was probably getting toward the end of the line. She shook her head, closed her eyes, and said, "This is happening too fast." A few days later, she died in her sleep, and it was a foregone conclusion that I would be writing her obituary. She looks good on paper. An obituary is a beautiful place to isolate all of the good parts while leaving out all of the bad parts. In her obituary, she went back to school receiving her master's degree in her 50s, but she was not left by my father for his receptionist. In her obituary, she was a beloved house mother in a sorority on the University of Wisconsin campus, but did not suffer from dementia. In her obituary, she was a fashion-forward woman who loved books, politics, her friends, and her family. Her essence was still there that last afternoon that I spent with her when she called Ron Johnson a jackass, so I included the last sentence. What I did not expect was the response her obituary would elicit. The Milwaukee Sentinel called for an interview, followed by the Wisconsin State Journal, and then a Fox affiliate from Milwaukee wanted a television interview. The newspaper articles went viral on social media. Dan Rather retweeted her story. USA Today picked it up, as did The Hill, Daily Cause, and Flip It. A woman with the handle Double D Mova posted a beautiful video on TikTok about my mom. A friend in LA texted, "Wowza, your mom is headlining my news feed." I received letters from Hawaii and Seattle and from all over Wisconsin. Then I see a headline saying, "Mom's dying wish, beat that guy." And then I saw the folly and the opportunism this sentence invited and turned down further requests for interviews. Obviously, this was not her dying wish. I projected it onto her. As an artist for roughly 40 years, very roughly, I've been trying to draw attention to my work and make headlines, but this was not about me. This was about my mom. And she left this world a shining star, making a difference, inspiring others, and making all sorts of good trouble. Thank you.
Hey everyone, we're the Teardowns from Morningside. Ryan, Nikki, Steve, Colin, Jeff, Liz, Mark, and me, Jim. It's been a heck of a year when we're ready for the sun to come out and to make this an amazing year coming up ahead. So, see you out there.
Here comes the sun.
Hi, my name is Duchess Harris, and I've written a book called Justice for George Floyd. I am a professor at McAllister College, but I'm also a mom. I have three kids, a 22-year-old, a 17-year-old, and a 14-year-old. And I write books like this for my kids and for your kids. This book is written on the level for 4th to 8th graders. And so what I'm going to share with you is chapter 4. Chapter 4 is entitled, A Man Who Made a Difference. George Floyd's death caused a wave of activism. Americans responded with anger, frustration, and sadness. People of all backgrounds came together. They protested what they felt were needless killings of Black people by police officers. Taking to the streets, they raised their voices. Their urgency matched the national civil rights movement of the 1950s and 1960s. This period of history included numerous protests against racism and discrimination. Support for George Floyd was seen in communities that had never been part of the Black Lives Matter event. From big cities to small towns, Americans gathered to demand change. People of all races, ages, and genders joined together. In some cities, police officers expressed their support as well. Some officers even knelt with or joined protesters. The protests put pressure on the Minneapolis Police Department. The public demanded it hold all the officers accountable for their actions. Chauvin was arrested on May 29th. He was charged with third-degree murder and second-degree manslaughter. On June 3rd, the three other officers were arrested. Quang, Lane, and Tao were charged with aiding and abetting. This means helping another person commit a crime. Lawyers for Quang and Lane opposed the charges. Quang and Lane were rookies. Chauvin was a training officer. The lawyers said that Quang and Lane were following orders. In some police departments, people who speak out against others are punished. Other officers may shun them. They may refuse to work with them. This makes officers' jobs harder. But the Minneapolis Police Department had a duty to intervene policy. This means officers must act if another officer is doing something wrong. Quang, Lane, and Tao did not stop Chauvin. The charges were a huge victory for people who had been demanding justice. Minnesota Attorney General Keith Ellison also raised the charges against Chauvin. He raised them from third-degree murder to second-degree murder. Third-degree murder means that there was no intent to harm the victim. Second-degree murder, however, means that harm was the intent, but there was no intent to kill. The higher charge increased the amount of time Chauvin could spend in prison to 40 years. So in October of last year, the third-degree charge was dropped. Two autopsies would provide important evidence in the trial. One was performed by the Hennepin County Medical Examiner. The other was a private autopsy done by the family. The two autopsies found different causes of Floyd's death. The private autopsy said Floyd died because he could not breathe. The county autopsy said Floyd died because his heart stopped. Both autopsies declared Floyd's death a homicide. This means his death was caused by another person. George Floyd's death captured the world's attention and inspired people everywhere to stand up and speak out against the injustices Black people have suffered. True change will take both time and effort, but the momentum of the movement is helping people fight against systemic racism and police brutality. Thank you for watching my reading. My book is Justice for George Floyd. My name is Duchess Harris, and I'm glad to share this with you. Thank you.
Thank you to all of the performers. What a show! And thank you to the sponsors for their support. We are so grateful to everyone in this community.
Over the off season, please visit our Facebook or Instagram pages, subscribe to our YouTube channel, or check out our new website at morningsideafterdark.com for archives and more.
Thank you so much, everyone. Please go support live music, buy books, do all you can to keep our incredible local performing culture so vibrant and unique. Stay safe, be well, and be sure to check out our social media and our website for exciting updates about 2022 when we go live for the 10th anniversary.